So welcome back, everybody. My name's Jeremy Wates. I'm Secretary General of the European Environmental Bureau, and I'm happy to be moderating this afternoon's session. And we're going to start with three reports back from the three breakout sessions. So without more ado, I'm going to call on the rapporteurs in turn to come and present their reports in about 5 minutes each. And then we will have around 10 or 15 minutes for a quick discussion, additions to their reports. And so first of all, I'd like to call on Jonathan Gaventer, Director of E3G, to present the report from the Climate and Energy Breakout Group. Jonathan.
Thanks very much. Well, we had a very lively discussion that covered quite a range of grounds. It really started by some reflections on actually how we go about talking about climate and energy and the sort of framing that we're using and the need to move away from, a somewhat technocratic framing of the issues and to start reconnecting with emotion and inspiring people, inspiring citizens. A discussion of the added value of looking at these things at a European level, but also the need to reconnect some of these discussions and frameworks back down to how are they making citizens' lives better. So we had a very specific proposition there, which is as part of the new European market design, citizens should have a right to self-production of renewable energy and also have a right to sell in flexibility services, demand-side response into the electricity market. The second big theme that you may have picked up on this morning that we came back to this afternoon was around the continuing ambition gap. We've got a tsunami of policies and legislation coming through, but as of yet, Europe is not on track to 1.5 and also not even on track to a well below 2 degrees scenario. Now, this is something that people were a bit frustrated that hasn't been able to cut through to leaders at European level, either in the European institutions or the member states. So the action point here is for those of us in the room and our networks elsewhere to not simply go, oh, we didn't manage ambition, so we'll drop it, but rather to keep building, keep coming back to it and making sure that we're building in that climate ambition into every piece of advocacy that we do and every measure that we're putting forward. The third theme was actually, it's not just about targets, it is about building in the frameworks themselves. So there was some discussion of enabling measures in terms of empowering cities to become more active on climate and energy issues, but also that there is this a whole set of legislation currently working its way through the European institutions. At the moment, we don't know whether it'll add up to just a long list of kind of names or directives or something that will be more transformative in our energy systems. And that's all still to play for. So another question that was raised is, you know, what's the potential of using these frameworks to phase out coal electricity, for example? The fourth theme, which we kept coming back to, was about following the money. You know, if you want to know if we're serious about the transition, look at where the money is going. At the moment, clean energy investment in Europe is falling. It should be rising. It is rising in many of our competitor countries and economies. And so that's something that we need to get better at. The European Commission is amending some of its approaches. The European Fund for Strategic Investments will have a set quantity for how much it spends on climate and energy issues. But overall, we need to get better at the enabling bits of the finance and also just stop spending money on the bad stuff, on dirty investments, which somehow we've not yet done. And the final theme was about infrastructure, that when we're talking about energy systems, we're not just talking about the flows of energy through the system, but we're talking about the long-lived assets that make up our energy system, not just the pipes and wires, but also our buildings, our appliances, our industries that shape how much we use. And so it was suggested that a different approach, a different framework for thinking about the energy and climate challenge is needed, one in which we see our built environment and energy efficiency measures as infrastructure themselves rather than only focusing on the flows that are going through.
Thank you, Jonathan. And if you'd like to take your seat up here, actually, and I call on Luke Bass from the director of the EU Office for IUCN to come and report on the biodiversity group. Thank you, Luke.
Thank you, Jeremy. Well, we had a very lively debate, and I think in the not in the other room, really, but almost next to us, there was also a lively debate. So we could almost have an integration of the two debates. But I think that's for a next step. Anyway, that was one of the themes that came through very much, is about integrating. And when you talk about biodiversity and nature, Natura 2000, implementation, and so on and so forth, that you'll to make your case and to make a step, a really leap forward, more of that integration will be needed. It was really a debate beyond this refit. And if you want to come back to that fitness check that we are all waiting for so eagerly and has been stalling on us for a few months, let's take one of the advantages is that all those months have been even useful to even gather more evidence of the fact that the more implementation is needed and that the structures work. So we had another 4 months to collect evidence, which I think we should look at it positively. So we didn't talk about that refit or that fitness check. No, we talked about the drivers, we talked about the actors, we talked about the stakeholders. And before I enter into more detail, I want to say that we talked a lot about agriculture because it's the hot issue at the moment. But I want to assure that everyone in that room didn't forget about the other big drivers, invasive alien species, habitat loss from infrastructure development, and so on and so forth. You know them, but it was all quite clearly focused on farmers. Not in the least because one of the presentations focused on the farmer. And one of the important points there was, of course, that there is no such thing as the farmer, of course. And there's all this huge diversity between the farmers and their intentions even, and about what they're producing, how they're producing it, and there's a big diversity there. So there's also this one size fits all that is an issue when you start looking at how things can be done better. One important thing that came through from one of those presentations and then the debate afterwards is, of course, okay, how do you... You'll have to work with the farmers. The farmers are in the front line. If we don't, as community, and let's say the nature or environment community, don't work with the farmers, it's not going to happen. So how do we get them fully on board, and how do we get more of them on board? One of the things that is worrying them is this uncertainty that sometimes pops up. So there was a lot of questions still asked. We don't have all the answers, but that was certainly one of these elements. How do you take away their fear for uncertainty? And that linked to why would farmers be doing it and how would they be doing it? What is the incentive? It can be different from one to the other, but one of the incentives, obviously, is that when they invest, or even beyond the farmer, other actors invest in taking care of their lands or in a restoration project, as somebody else pointed out, in the context of the connectivity laws that exists, and so where your restoration can reconnect those nature areas again, why would you invest? And that brought us to this very contentious issue of, okay, how do you value then that nature to make sure that when you invest, instead of looking at it as a cost, but you invest in nature, that it also is an investment and that the investment and all the benefits that come from it are somehow translated. First of all, well communicated, but yes, at some point it might have to be translated into some economic value, which immediately brings you in the danger zone of, and we all know this, the commodification of nature, which is something obviously that nobody wants. And even people talking about banking nature, which is even more of a doom. But yes, there was some kind of feeling that we have to find ways to make sure that there is some integration into the system and into where, honestly, the hard and the real decisions today are being made. So we'll have to make that case, apart from that economic value, jobs, and health benefits, and all these others. We all know it, but we seem not to get it through into the minds of the high-level decision makers. And then the last point, maybe from this session, was also quite striking and came from a presentation and I honestly don't remember the organization's name, but an organization in Germany that's working on satellite imaging, but also translating what's actually happening on the land and into quite a lot of detail. And they've been successful globally, and some of their assessments of what happened on the land has actually caused different investments to be made, just not in Europe, strangely enough. That system seems to be able to exactly track what happens to the land use and how the land use change is happening. But it's not being supported at the moment. It doesn't seem to be embraced. You would think that policymakers would be lining up with the organization to get all that information to make the right decisions, and it's not happening. Another big why question, but it's there, and I can already assure you that IUCN, through its work and its collecting of data and its world database on protected areas, will seek how we can actually work closely with them to see how that information can help making the right decisions. As a last point, and it's something, and I have to excuse because I wasn't there in the morning, so I hope that the SDGs and the Sustainable Development Goals and that policy, that big policy framework, came into the debate. But I think from the debate, if we want to integrate, we have to link it at these bigger goals that are out there, the SDGs, and how what we do in Europe on nature and conservation, and of course on the other themes mentioned here on circular economy and climate change, also really fit into that SDG. And it can be an opportunity to get some attention from the policymakers. And we have to do it now, because in a year's time, unfortunately, experience tells us that it slows down the interest and it filters away. So let's hope that this SDG implementation and the upcoming communication from the Commission gives us some tools there as well. That's where I think I would leave it, connected to the global discussion. If you look at land use policies, it's not just agriculture, we all know that. And if you want to be, some people talked about we need a shock therapy. Shock therapy, sometimes some people call it revolution. In the energy and the climate field, you had this debate about the clean revolution. So maybe, but this is not the opinion of IUCN, it's just from the feeling in the room, maybe we need a land use revolution and have some proper common land use policy, even beyond common agriculture policy. Thanks.
Thank you, Luke. If you'd like to take your seat. And you can all be thinking about the additional points you want to make on these two reports. And now I call on Ian Gunnand from Zero Waste Scotland to report from the Circular Economy Group.
Okay. Ian. Thank you very much, Jeremy. Thank you. Great opportunity to talk with you. It was quite interesting because we started talking about some of the barriers to progressing the circular economy, and one of them was around Brexit. The fact that a lot of people were now focused on that rather than focused on the circular economy package. So just to put things straight, that's nothing to do with me, Brexit. Nothing to do with me. I hope everybody remembers that Scotland voted to remain in Europe. Just not to make that political point, because obviously you know, very much look forward to working with you all on that and collaborating with you, etc. And that's a very important point, because I think that is part of what we're talking about today, is we have common, not just challenges, not just within Europe, but globally, but also common opportunities to work together and collaborate. So hopefully that will continue going forward. I think the key thing we did talk about, we didn't actually talk too much about the barriers, to be honest. That was just probably something at the beginning that was put forward. We did really talk about the opportunities for really driving change going forward, because I think the real sense of our group was lots of hope, lots of excitement, lots of opportunity. I mean, it's clearly a circular economy is already happening. We had a great presentation from the Fairphone company about what they're doing. I mean, this is happening, and I know from my own experience in Scotland that there are a number of companies who are either currently reviewing their business model, looking at leasing and lending and hiring and working out what that would look like for them as a company. But more importantly, there are innovators within Scotland, and I'm sure there's innovators right across Europe who are thinking in a different way than they've thought before, or innovators have thought before about business. And so I think we all recognize that. So I think what we really tried to focus on, how can we accelerate that? How can we make this work faster? And what, I think the question we were posed was, who needs to do what, was the kind of question that Frederick challenged us with. So I think we all did agree that there's a huge role for the consumer, going back to the Fairphone example, that these things exist, these opportunities for more circular design or more circular products do exist. Hiring, we even heard from Walter about hiring a Christmas tree just every year, not for the full year, but just Christmas time and everything that goes with it. So there's lots of opportunities that are there, and I guess we recognise that. How do we make that more available to people? How do we make more products and services available to the consumer? So we need to make the conditions a lot easier for businesses, innovative startup businesses and existing businesses to adopt. So how can we do that? So we did start looking at creating the right conditions, I guess, at EU level, looking at regulation policy level. So we talked about producer responsibility, we talked about targets, the right targets. We talked about economic instruments. We even discussed a Europe-wide deposit return scheme for bottles and plastics and aluminium cans. We talked about design standards, the common design standards across Europe. We talked about labelling, and again, coming back to the consumer, the importance of labelling, so the consumer actually understands what they're buying into, and it's trustworthy, and it's backed up with hard evidence, and people actually understand it, what that all means. Reporting the right numbers, right definitions, we talked about that, not just understanding what you see all these brands on various things, climate neutral and good for the environment. What do these actually mean in practice? But also things like defining what is waste and what's not waste, what's a byproduct, etc. Because a lot of those things are actually barriers to progress. And it was about trying to be smarter. It was about looking at what currently exists and how could these processes or regulations or policy instruments, could they be reshaped in a different way rather than just throw them out with the bathwater, to actually think about how they could be shaped in a different way. There was a bit of debate about that, whether the current system just needs a radical overhaul. Will trying to shape the current system just take too long, and we will miss this opportunity for a collective action? So there was a bit of debate about that. But I think we all did agree that in that there is an opportunity for us all to be, I think the word was braver, in every walk of life, the people in this room, or business leaders, or entrepreneurs, or politicians, both at national level and at local level, to be braver and to seize this opportunity. Don't wait for somebody else to imagine what the circular economy will look like. It is there in front of you. So there's a bit of a two-pronged attack about getting out and getting people to imagine what the future might look like, but at local level, community level, city level, at nation level. We talked a bit about that, about some of the interesting stuff that's happening, and we heard from Walter about Sweden and some of their changes in their taxation system. So it's clearly out there. Another point, and that goes, I think it echoes what fellow speaker up here just said about emotion, about tapping into emotion. I think we all agree that the numbers speak for themselves, the data's there, the circular economy is going to be fantastic, it's going to a huge impact on climate change as well as the environment, as well as the economy, but we need to appeal to the emotion to some extent in the politicians and businesses as well. And clearly we all talked about, recognise that jobs does that. I think we all agreed. We all had really good experience of where mentioning the word this could create local jobs does make people prick up their ears, particularly local politicians. Now, you know, I guess we all imagine that climate change is the most important thing that we should all be tackling, but if it's jobs that gets them thinking about the circular economy, then so be it. But we all did finally agree on a couple of things. Well, main thing was collaboration, that we can't do this ourselves, not just the people in this room. We do need to go out and collaborate with a whole host of possibly new people that we've not worked with before, industry, people in business, people like Fairphone who are got an idea, who want to progress this. There will be other people in businesses with similar ideas. How do we work with them? How do we work with industry leaders? Designers, we talked a lot about designers, having been in Brussels recently, a design festival, working with, talking to designers, recognise that they're bursting to get out of their silos and collaborate with the likes of ourselves and the circular economy and other people and industry to think about how they can help. But we need to reach out to them and create an interface with those types of people. Talked about green procurement, the opportunities for green procurement really to drive this, particularly in public procurement, really drive this, create a market for circular economy products. and services. And finally, we touched upon the need, and I think it was Walter this morning that talked about the need to get this into schools, universities, not just young people, but business leaders that are coming through, the future business leaders, to really embed this in the future. So this is not just us, with every respect, talking about it. This is future generations who won't just be talking about it, but they'll be doing it. And that collaboration and education, for me, really has to be inclusive as well. With every respect, I spend a lot of time talking to people who already understand the circular economy or the concepts of it, but we do need to reach out to those people, because this is all about disruption. And in my experience, disruption really does happen at the margins. So if we're really not inclusive, then we're going to kind of almost create a bit of a steady state with a bit of a shift in the path. But we really want to have a transformative agenda. We need an inclusive approach to this and bring as many people into the tent as possible. And those are the disruptors. Hopefully there'll be disruptors in that crowd that we invite in to really make this change. And there was a question somebody posed about what is the perfect material that we should be using in the circular economy. And whilst there were some fantastic answers to that and a couple of sidesteps, for me, there's a sense sometimes we can't imagine that. I don't think I can imagine what the actual solution looks like. I think that's part of it for me, is in terms of disruption, that what I know will probably inhibit. If everybody followed what I know, then I think we will inhibit the journey. I think it is about somebody out there, somebody who's not in this room, people who are not in this room, who will make this change and bring in the circular economy. So I think we just have to open up that idea and let it go. Which I know can be quite scary, particularly for policymakers and industrial people and even society in general, that the future is in somebody else's hands. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Ian. If you'd like to sit up here, come and join us up here. And now's your chance to add some points to these reports. And I think they, for me, not having been in all three sessions, of course, they sounded very coherent, and I'm impressed that they put these together very quickly, but maybe there are still some points to add. Michael Bender?
Thank you so much for your engaged presentations. I don't want to add, but in the first group we had the idea of clean energy and bad energy. Bad energy is a coal energy, clean energy is a renewable energy, and how to fulfill our aims of the climate change and everything. And the second, we have the biodiversity, how can we save this? So it would be good if you both could discuss a little bit how we can prevent biodiversity loss and loss of the last biodiversity hotspots due to new hydropower development, due to bioenergy, due to all the things that should be good, but are, in terms of biodiversity, quite harmful also. So what is the right way? And we have to find answers for the society that we propose on the way forward. This is the one question. The other question on the third group would be, you told us about circular economy, and I'm very much in favor of this, also about regional products, regional cycles, and procurement, yes. But then I think we have to address much more the issue of internal market regulations, because you have companies and institutions that can go to court for you if you want to say to your state authorities, make sustainable public procurement. They set up rules, and someone comes, oh, I want to deliver this to you, I will go to court due to internal market regulations. And on global scale, we also have this other kind of trade agreements that are completely in contradiction to what we want with a circular economy. I think we have to address this much more. Thank you.
Okay, should we start with a bioenergy, biodiversity question, gentlemen?
Yeah, I think that's a very positive question for a discussion like this. I mean, I think in talking about clean energy, we really should be talking about clean and sustainable energy. And it kind of pains me sometimes that in this day and age, we still have to make that distinction. I really see two avenues or two options for addressing this. First of all, I mean, a key theme of our discussions was about the demand side rather than just supply side. So I don't know of any examples, there may be some, but I certainly don't know of any examples where energy efficiency investments have been used to destroy habitats, for example. And similarly, decentralized energy, solar power on rooftops, generally has relatively little biodiversity impacts. The second option is a more proactive approach from those of us who support nature conservation in engaging with energy policymakers about what's a suitable investment and what's a non-suitable investment. I know BirdLife and others have done a lot of work on mapping to visually represent different zones of wind power or electricity lines can be acceptable in these areas, but a major cause for concern in these areas. If you invest in these areas, we won't object. If you invest in these areas, we'll take you to court. Those sorts of messages do break through because they do start to hit the bottom lines of the people that put the money behind it.
Thank you. Luke, do you want to add anything from your group?
The group didn't discuss it, but so I'll add my personal perspective, if I may. And I like very much how you pointed immediately to the demand side and talked about energy efficiency, and I want to take it even a level further. It has to be really about savings in the end, because that's this famous efficiency paradox that we don't assure that we will use less. There's a lot of renewable energy deployment that can be done without much risk of harm. And of course, yes, it adds another, and then we don't even talk about bioenergy. That's another subject. Just for the deployment of the sustainable renewable energy. But it adds another aspect to development, of course, that we have to take into account and where we have to also be very bold and then also implement it to say that there are indeed no-go zones for renewable energy. And we are very fierce, very strict on it. There is enough space out there, enough room to have enough deployment of renewable energy not to have to harm biodiversity. It's just sometimes easier to do it like that. And that's where, of course, we need the right regulation and enforcement. And then it comes to the same challenges with other infrastructure and development. So, but it adds on top of the already high pressure, indeed. Yeah. Maybe one initiative that's really important that is often forgotten is the Renewable Grid Initiative, where they also look at the next step of when you have deployed your production, that you have to also transport it. And that's, I think, one of the bigger challenges even that we sometimes overlook.
Thank you. Ian? The last question.
So yeah, I think what you were asking was if we go towards a circular economy procurement model that could disrupt the kind of free market or certainly impact on the idea of the free market. And I think that's this kind of interesting question again, and it's probably part of what we were discussing. Does the current regulation or the current system, i.e. the EU procurement guidance, does that inhibit the move to circular economy, you know, and if it does because of certain aspects to it, or doesn't enhance it, then do we need to evolve that piece of policy or that piece of regulation? And I guess that's the challenge that I think we will all have, and I can understand how at EU level there is a challenge there. How do you evolve something, or the other word is, in terms of a revolution, do you just start again? Do you just have to design EU procurement around the circular economy, right, with still maintaining the idea of the free market? Because I think we all want to do that. I think that's clear for us all about this. This is about collaboration and innovation across Europe and globally as well. So if we're accessing good practice in one country, why can't we access that good practice across Europe? So I don't think anybody's saying that, but it is an interesting question for me about, you know, does that system, because that's what we get told when we go to procurement, public procurement people in Scotland, and they'll say, oh, we can't do that. Just couldn't do that. So you kind of think in the hierarchy of trying to achieve something. It's not to say it's wrong procurement, because it's obviously there for a particular reason, but how can you make that, how can you evolve that to some extent to allow circular economy? So it's not kind of lurch to, I guess that's what we're debating. You could just rub it out and start again, and it would take a lot of time and a lot of machinations. But how can you evolve that to ensure that there's a future way of doing stuff that we're all trying to get to? How can you, without, you know, creating the drag on current things. And that's not to say these things were set up wrongly, they were set up for very good reason. And I think that's just the challenge I think we all have.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions? I see one hand here and we leave it at that then. So if you make the questions short.
So I'm Harald Badenhagen from Licht und Natur from Germany, and I would like to add some words to Luke's very good conclusion. There's a threat that is often overseen, and that is the threat against biodiversity by artificial light at night. So, for example, we see a significant loss of insects, and this significant loss of insects forces agriculture to use more toxic on the agricultural land. And so, on the other side, for example, the new LED technology that is cost efficient or energy efficient, so that is the myth about LEDs. On the other side, we can see a rebound effect because lighting is so cheap. More and more lighting is installed. And I think we should have an answer to this or an action against this because that is really a threat against biodiversity. And when we lose to, or when, and we do, when we do not point also to half of the 24 hours day, the night, then we lose half of the task we have to take over.
Thanks. Thank you. Harald, do you want to respond to that point, or you take it as a comment to it? Just as a matter of information, yesterday the EEB medium-term strategy for the next 3 years was adopted with the inclusion of a reference to this issue and the linkages with that there are with other issues. It's an issue that I think not so many people know too much about, so it's good that your organizations are putting this on the radar. One very quick question to Luke. You talked about the need to build bridges with farmers. Did you in your group discuss at all the possibility that there won't be an assumption among civil society organizations that 40% of the EU budget is going to go to the cap? Because the last time round, there was a kind of assumption that the cap would be greened, and therefore the NGOs in particular did not challenge the amount. And then, of course, the amount was approved and the greening was stripped away. Of course, if you enter the next round with the assumption that this may not, there won't be this support, then it's also more difficult to build the good relations with the farmers. It sounds like you didn't discuss it, but I'm curious because it's a pretty key issue in the coming discussions on the next round of CAP reform.
Yeah, that's the expectation management part of the debate as well. Huh? Yeah, and we didn't have the whole sociological analysis there at the same time. But it's definitely a point that needs to be addressed. Fortunately, we only had this 1 hour and a bit. What I do think is that with the reform as it is on the table now, which I think the larger NGO community was and is still and was quite immediately disappointed with the level of where it went. And then, of course, now the question marks pop up on how well is it implemented, so the last greening.
Yes.
But there are, and I think there we have to be a bit honest that the actual, we expect it, because we see examples, but the actual assessment still has to be done. That is where we have to be honest about that. So let's look at what has happened then, and then use all the proof to convince the farmers to do it right the next time. And make sure that there is no reason to go around the rules. But I think at the moment, we've seen the past, and of course we see that it didn't go right there. The new phase, and I sound like I'm defending a little bit the Commission's position here, but honestly we have to still see. There is still some lapse of time that we have to see what actually has been done.
But
the fears are high, anyway, that's true.
I think the information that is coming in is pretty alarming, that it's not good news, basically. Gentlemen, thank you very much for giving these reports, and perhaps a round of applause. Best, So if you'd like to take your seats again, and we move into a different chapter of this conference, because, of course, most of what we've been talking about today is what's happening in Europe, and that's understandable. We are the European Environmental Bureau, and it's a European conference. But we all know very well, and it's come through in many interventions today, that everything we're doing in Europe is in a global context. We've talked about the safe operating space for humanity, planetary boundaries, and so on. And it's absolutely crucial that we keep an eye on the global processes and that Europe is playing its full role in that, both at the governmental level, also at the civil society level. And I'm very happy that over the last three or four years, the EEB's really stepped up its engagement in global processes, such as those with UNEP on the environment and those in the Rio Plus 20 follow-up process, which led to the SDGs. We've done this through the creation of a special unit, the Global Policies and Sustainability Unit, which came out of integrating ANPED into the EEB. And we've been able to play quite a central role in shaping the civil society part of the agenda for UNEA 2 that happened in May, and also before that, we co-organized the European preparatory meeting for UNEA. And so we thought it would be very good to have someone to bring a kind of a global voice from from UNEP, in fact, into this conference, and to give that perspective, who could be the better person than the incoming executive director, recently appointed executive director of UNEP, the former Norwegian Environment Minister, Erik Solheim. So we were delighted that he was willing to give an input. Unfortunately, because it's his first 2 months in the job, and you can imagine what kind of a job that is, he was not able to come here in person, but he has kindly provided a keynote address for us in the form of a video message. So now we have a video message from the UNEP Executive Director, Erik Solheim.
Let me start with a vote of thanks. We give a double vote of thanks. First, a vote of thanks to the European Union. Without you spearheading any number of global causes for the environment, I think we would have been in great jeopardy. Mary, always, there is a great issue. European Union is in the lead, or at least close to the big issue. So thank you to the European Union. If the European Union, and this very difficult part of the Union, if it had not been in existence already, somehow we need
to have invented the European Union. But also thanks to the European Environment Bureau and to all the civil society activists of Europe, without you always pushing the European politicians to do more, we would have been in much greater difficulties. And we need this, the political leadership, but also the political leadership always pushed by, inspired by the citizens. Let me also thank you for two particular milestones where you have been very critical to driving the change. One is the Aarhus Convention about access to information on the environment. You were the drivers behind the public campaign for people to have the right to know. Thank you. And thank you also for the Zero Mercury campaigns. Again, you brought together any number of civil society organizations behind this campaign, and it led ultimately to the Minamata Convention, named after the city in Japan where so many people died and were disabled from mercury, and which is now gradually being endorsed by nearly all countries in the world. The role of civil society and citizens is absolutely critical for any green movement, for any progress on the environment. Look to the most advanced economies of the world. Nearly everywhere we have decoupled polluting from economic growth. They have rapid economic development, while at the same time restoring the situation of the nature. In my city, in Oslo, you can today dive out from the town hall right into the fjord. True, it will be chilly, but it's clean. And you can catch some fishes and you can eat them and no one would be concerned. Because a few decades back, that was a very polluted fjord and the city was much more polluted than it is today. But if this can happen in the developed, advanced economies of the world, it can obviously happen everywhere. But the key to progress is the combination of citizens' movements with brave politicians, with business providing the technical and operational answers. And I will claim that maybe Germany is the best example. That's probably the one nation on the planet to have the best policies. I mean, it's not the nation with the best situation for nature everywhere, but it's probably the nation who have made the most adamant political decisions to improve the quality of the nature. How did that happen? Well, there was a strong citizens' movement. There was a strong Green Party putting pressure on all the established political parties. And Germany has a chancellor who has been environment minister and has a big heart for and a strong dedication to move on environment. If that German example of the combination of business, political leadership, and citizens' movement can be replicated in the rest of the world, we will make huge progress forward. But if we believe that citizens' movements are at the center of environmental progress, there are some lessons to be learned. I think we need to change track, civil society, but also we in the UN on some issues. We need to speak a language of the people out there, not a technical language, not an intellectual language, not a language only understood by those who are already within the movement. So for that reason, I've decided that we will speak about United Nations Environment rather than about UNEP, and that we will abolish any sort of acronym or technical terminology within our organization. Whenever we communicate with the people out there, it should be understandable for my mother and for my adult children. If it's not understood by them, how can I believe that it will be understood in the streets of Madrid or Warsaw? And we need also to focus on environment issues which are dear to people, close to people, and where people really take an interest. Pollution is such an issue. The rapid, horrendous plastic pollution of the oceans is another issue. The food waste, again, is another issue. And to get a much more sustainable consumption pattern and production pattern and in Europe, these are issues close to people and which we can communicate and speak with people in a completely new fashion, because without people's engagement, we will come nowhere. Let me at the end point to a few key issues if we really want to reach out to the citizens of Europe and the wider world. I believe one is pollution. 7 million people are dying every year on this planet due to bad air or bad water. That's more or less the same number as those dying from cancer. How can that continue? It must stop. And I think we will reach out to people in a very new way. If we link pollution and health, people simply do not want to breathe bad air. Another issue is the oceans. As humans, we traditionally had the attitude that, oh, oceans are so big, you can throw anything into them and it will never come back. And you can pick any fish, you can fish any fish from the oceans, and the fish stocks will restore themselves. Well, this is simply not the case. We must stop the horrendous, obscene plastic pollutions of the oceans. We must restore the fish stocks of this world, and we need to protect the coral reefs, and we need a lot more marine national parks, both in the territorial water of nations and in the open sea in the Atlantic and the Pacific. Only jointly we can do this. And we need to work on business and finance. That's key to any progress. Fortunately, many companies now are far ahead of political leaders, not lagging behind. Companies like, say, Unilever or Nestlé or Kellogg's are spearheading change. Many car companies are rolling out electrical vehicles. And let me point to the French oil company Total, who's now said that they will not drill in the Arctic because of climate science. Very brave statement. And they said that it will be one of the three biggest solar companies on the planet by 2030. Again, a huge change. So we need to get the green finances right, and we need to work with business. And frankly, as civil society, very often you have been far too critical of business. You need to name and shame those businesses who do poorly, but you also need to name and fame those businesses who do the right thing. And finally, of course, biodiversity and the beauty of this planet, which we got from the Almighty. It's so beautiful. There is such a variety of species of animals and flowers and plants. How can we be the generation which destroys it? So we need to protect the rainforests, the wetlands, and the territorial forest, all the fantastic ecosystems on the planet. And we will speak to people if you tell them about the fantastic elephant, the jaguar, the orangutan, all those species which we cannot be the generation destroying. But for all these issues, whether it's pollution or oceans or ecosystems or finance, we can never do without you, without the citizens, and without the engagement of the civil society. We will come nowhere. So please push ahead, put pressure on business, put pressure on governments, but work with both politicians and business leaders to make the change.
Well, thank you, Erik. I know you can't hear me, but thank you anyway. Well, now we have two respondents, two speakers who are going to respond to some of the issues that have been raised, and I'd like to invite up to the stage Elisabeth Freytag-Rigler and Céline Charveriat. And Elisabeth, or Sissi as you're more usually known, you're an official with the Austrian Ministry, but you also have a European hat as the chair of the management board of the EEA. And you even have a third hat, which isn't written in the program, which is a very strong supporter of civil society organizations, the EEB Umweltdachverband, which is very much appreciated. And Céline, you are relatively new as taking over as the executive director of the Institute for European Environmental Policy. It's great to welcome you on the platform of this EEB conference. Your predecessor was sitting in a similar chair sometimes before, so welcome. And I'd like to put three questions to you of issues that came up in this video. But of course, you don't need to feel constrained by the questions. You can stray outside that as well. And maybe if we could have a bit more natural light. Ah, yes, it's happening already in the room. A bit less external noise would be good, but we can't really control that. So, I mean, the first thing, and I mean, I don't know what the audience thought about this, but I have to ask the question, is Erik Solheim being a bit too positive about the EU and Europe? I mean, in how many European capitals can you safely take a dip in the local river? And also, yes, developed economies have made great progress in decoupling economic growth from environmental impact, including in Europe. But Europe's environmental footprint, surely it's still exceeding its fair share by far. So what can we be proud of, and where do we need to try harder? And then second point on businesses. He's really criticizing governments for lagging behind many businesses. Is he right on this, or is this really just half of the story? What about the business laggards? Are the pressures for deregulation letting those laggards off the hook and preventing a level playing field? And thirdly, then, he talks very passionately, and I think in a very inspiring way, about the key role of citizen mobilization. But he also gives us some advice, a little bit critical advice, about the need to differentiate between good and bad business and using less jargon. I think we do that already, but, well, do you agree with his advice, and would you add any of your own advice? So there's three questions to kick off, but as I say, feel free to stray outside. Sissi.
Thank you, Jeremy. It's a pleasure being here, and it's a pleasure attending an EEB conference in Vienna. I usually attend your conferences in Brussels as well, but of course it's nice to have you next door to my office. May I start by saying that I really like his point of abolishing abbreviations. Whenever I read a report from the climate negotiations, I can hardly follow what they write, even so I follow climate policy for a few years already. And I really like his point where he says we should speak a language that people can understand. And I said I very much like EEB conferences because I know many people here, and it's so nice to come to kind of a big family. But on the other hand, it's also important that we speak to others and to people outside and to businesses and not only to the Environment Ministry and to other ministries. So abolishing abbreviations is a very nice point. But coming to your question, when he talks about Norway and jumping into the fjord, I mean, he could have talked about Austria as well. The quality, the water quality has improved considerably since the 1970s, and I think this is the same for all EU member states. We spent a lot of money on wastewater treatment, and this is good so. And I also think that the air quality improved a lot. When I lived in Budapest in the 1990s and it was raining, then all the cars were black afterwards because it was so dirty, and now this is not the case there. We did a lot on waste management. We have talked today about circular economy that has to do a lot with waste, and I think we are also in waste management a lot better than before. But I don't think that we should kind of rest on our laurels, because a lot has happened in other parts of the world as well. A lot has happened in the US, a lot has happened in China. I was in China this summer, and I think they are a lot better than we on e-mobility, for example. So it's not only us who did something in the last years. And we started with our environmental policy in 1972 in all the European countries, of course. And we can be proud of the last 30, 40 years. But I think there are different things at stake now. It's sustainable development, it's resources, it's consumer behavior. And as you mentioned, my function in Copenhagen in the European Environment Agency, the executive director there, Hans Breunings, he's a professor for transition, or he was a professor for transition. And he always says technology is important, but if we all had a Tesla, we still had a traffic jam in the Rue de la Loire, because it's about mobility concept. And you mentioned today that services are important, so he also talks a lot about services and about how can we save resources by providing services instead of buying products all the time. When he talked about Germany, he said it's political will, business, and citizens' movement, and probably he's right. We need political will. I think the minister said it this morning. Karl Falkenberg, who was quoted several times today in his report, says we need political will. We need the highest leaders, the European Council, to say that we should have a European sustainable development strategy. And also the European Parliament, I mean, politicians in the Parliament, in the resolution from May this year that I like very much, ask for an overarching strategy. And I think we all do hope that this political will also lead one day to a European strategy. Also, I have to say that the rumors from the Commission maybe are not exactly in this direction, but let's wait and see what comes from the communication later this year. And businesses, I think businesses are very important. There are front runners. I mean, we in Austria have a long tradition in working with social partners. Social partners have a right from the constitution to be consulted, as ministries have a right. But social partners, of course, they always have to defend their weakest members. So it's the smallest common denominator. And we all very often have the impression or the experience that there are individual companies, big companies, small companies that are front runners and that are a lot better than the legislation that we have and that can push the governments on the European and on the national level. And of course, the role of NGOs is important. I think I don't have to say it in this context, but as you said, we have a lot of contact to the European NGOs, and we work closely together with the Austrian European Environment Bureau, and I think Bernhard and the Ministry, we do a lot together in many different fields. What was your last question?
The last question was about the citizen mobilization issue, but I mean, I think, you know, we can move on and come back in the discussion time, and perhaps we need to as well. So, Céline, what would you add, or how do you take, what's your approach to these questions from a non-governmental perspective?
Well, thank you first for welcoming me. I come from the development field. I was a campaigns director in Oxfam for a long time, so taking the SDGs, you know, quite seriously. I've now moved to the environmental field, and I hope that the two fields can work better together. So thanks for the opportunity. You were talking about, you know, sleeping on our laurels. This is a bit of a European specialty and a lot of victimization. Oh, no one looks at all the wonderful things we do. Can't the world see that we're trying really hard? Yes, we've done a lot of great things, but when you look, when you base yourself on science and where we need to be in 2050, I'd like to really focus on one issue, which is consumption. Clearly, there's an SDG number 12 on sustainable production and consumption. There is no way, barring something very different, that we will achieve it in 2030. And if you look, you know, our European lifestyle, and Falkenberg said that in the report, if we wanted to extend it for 10 billion in 2050, you would need natural resources from two planet Earth. That's how far we are from where we need to be. If you look at climate change, and I know this is a very controversial issue in terms of defining what would be the fair share in the carbon budget, but, you know, we did research together, and that's the NGOs that I was working with the Stockholm Environmental Institute, and we looked really at responsibility and capacity. If you take 1990, so I'm not talking in the Industrial Revolution, 1990, and if you don't differentiate very much countries' capacity according to income, even then, Europe does one-fifth of its per capita fair share. One-fifth. This is how far we have to go. And I hear a lot of people saying, oh, but look at all those rich Chinese. Look, if you include the not only our production emissions, but our consumption emissions, the picture is even worse. And actually, there's evidence that shows that the consumption of the 10% richest Chinese is pretty much at a par with the 40% poorest Europeans. So even the poorest members of our society tend to consume the same or more than the richest members of the emerging countries. So I think we really need to celebrate successes because it gives us confidence that we can do things, but also be science-based and be truthful about the way to go. In terms of businesses, I actually tend to agree with Erik Solheim. I think companies are very critical to any major change. If you look at the Montreal Convention, it was actually the decision of DuPont to change its business model that had by far the biggest impact in the field. I worked on AIDS for many years. The person who should get the Nobel Peace Prize is an Indian generic manufacturer who, from one day to another, divided the price of antiretrovirals by 10. And if you look at the data, it's very clear what happens then. So I think companies are very important to secure any sort of change. And I think the other mistake is to see the business sector as a monolithic sector. Obviously, there are laggards and there are pioneers. And I think NGOs can do much more to actually differentiate the laggards from the pioneers. And if you do that, you actually can have change happening. So Oxfam did a campaign on the 10 biggest food companies, comparing each other according to some specific criteria. And we looked at their mitigation efforts, including scope 3 emissions. And very soon, they started competing against each other to be on top of the ranking. If you had just said, oh, the business sector is not doing enough on climate change, nothing would have happened. So I think there's much more that we can do. I think where I can see a quite intractable problem is when governments are colluding with the laggards. And I think that's one of our toughest problems. So Erik Solheim is citing Germany as this great example, but look at the influence of the car and the chemical industry in Germany. You know, what a tremendous detrimental impact on policies and expectations. And the worst thing, you know, at least for somebody who comes from the social field, is that it doesn't stop workforces from going into a painful transition. It just delays the moment into an other electoral cycle. That's what happens. So I think we need to find better ways, maybe working with the human rights community, to really attack what I call business capture of government. One final thing, deregulation. I know it's a tough issue, very polarized between business and NGOs, But I feel the truth as often is in the middle. There are genuine problems with regulation in Europe. They need to be solved. And I think NGOs should have the courage to work with those serious businesses to define a positive agenda for better regulation. Finally, on citizen mobilization. Look, 10% of EU population is aware of what their governments have committed to as part of the SDGs, 10%. That's pretty low. So we have a pretty big job for ourselves, I can tell you. And for having, you know, managed large campaign teams, I think one of the biggest problems in having narratives that speaks to hearts and minds is asking policy people to come up with them. And very often the discussions are way too policy-led. And we actually need to bring very different people in the room if you want to come with the right sort of narratives. Thanks.
Great. Thank you to both of you. And now we have just a few minutes for if you have any reactions, either to Erik Solheim's remarks or to the remarks of the two respondents. Gentleman over there.
Well, speaking as a representative of the non-EU from Norway, I think one of the most important things that the EU can do, at least outside the EU, is to be an example, at least for the things that the EU does well. And I think there's so much transparency from civil society and the NGOs and also government in their corporate social responsibility reporting with PRI, GRI, and all the acronyms, that it doesn't matter whether the government reports what the bad things are. The bad things are going to come out anyway to the world. But there are enough good examples of innovation, especially looking at it from a non-EU viewpoint, let's say 29 plus, from experience in the United States, one of the most important things that the EU has done over the last 15 years is ETAP, the Environmental Technology Action Plan. And the funding that you put into climate change and environmental technology, it's, first of all, it's very simple to use, it's easy to access, the information is transparent and accessible, which is, it's exactly the opposite in the United States. Nobody understands the funding mechanisms in the United States, least of all the scientists who are trying to write the grants. And so the EU can help many other countries and multilateral organizations develop, for example, these kinds of innovation systems and networks for environmental technology. And so I would advise the EU to play up your strengths and don't wear a hair shirt and walk around and self-flagellate.
Great, thank you very much. Any other comments? Yeah, I see a hand right at the back there. It's Georges Sangal.
Right, Georges Sangal from France, Southwest. I want to react because negotiating with companies is, first of all, not so easy. And I will say that all the activists are not really well trained to this sort of exercise. But I want to point out, because I do negotiate with companies, small businesses, but medium-sized and even big companies. But if you do not have adequate regulations, negotiation is hopeless. I give you just one example, which is the consumption of materials to prepare concrete, that is to say gravels. There is no regulation preventing citizens from building walls with concrete blocks. They could use wood or recyclable things, but concrete blocks, we are sure that in the long run, they will not be recycled because They are disseminated everywhere in the countryside, and so they will be dumped, and again we will have one more environmental problem. I don't have a crystal ball, but I have more than a 30 years activist experience, and this is why I wanted to take the floor. Thank you.
Thank you, Georges. And very final comment from the left of the room there, and then short reactions.
Thank you, Jeremy. Andrei from Ukraine, side environment. My comment and question is about the leadership and the role of the EU beyond the EU borders. In Ukraine, having this association process with the EU, we look at, and some civil society groups are very excited at the implementation process of the EU acquis. Many groups see environmental acquis from the EU as raising the standards for environmental protection and bringing benefits. At the same time, some groups are very much concerned about what's being told as double standards, for example, basically meaning that the EU money is spent in Ukraine for infrastructure projects or, for example, through the European Investment Bank as loans to agriculture programs. Right now, our parliament ratifies 3 million euros loan from the EIB for agriculture. And the environmental safeguards in reality doesn't work. For example, EIA or Birds Directive or Habitats Directive or SCA even. We have examples where the money are being used, the EU money are being used to develop agriculture strategies in Ukraine without any SCA. My question is that I would like you to react to the following, let's say, line of thinking, that this, let's say, medal of leadership that the EU is often puts on its jacket, for example, like in the address we heard today from UNEP executive director, at the same time puts a lot of responsibility on the EU for what it does beyond the borders. For the leadership, at the same time, it is an appraisal, of course, but also it puts additional responsibilities on the EU, including the institutions and member states. I'd like to hear the reaction on that.
Thank you, Andre. That's almost enough for another seminar, but very, very good point. So, who's going to go first? Just quick reactions to these comments.
Yes, thank you. Of course, we need legislation. Even so, as I said, businesses are front runners, or some of them are. I really think that we need legislation. And Austrian or German companies that were mentioned by Erik Solheim, they made a lot of money because of the fact that in the 1970s, 80s, 90s, we had strict regulations in our countries. So environmental technology was invented also on the basis of strict legislation. And I think it's a good idea to have strict legislation and then the companies make money out of it. So it is a good combination, but I don't think one should only count on voluntary actions from businesses. One more word maybe on the agenda 2030, because I have the feeling that, including myself, people say, dear Commission, please come forward, dear Commission, please do something. I just wanted to say that in the ESDN, the European Sustainable Development Network, we said we stop. I mean, we don't stop asking the Commission to do something. But in the meantime, we think we could learn from each other, because a lot is happening in many member states. Some of them were at the high-level political forum in July, like Finland, for example, or Germany. So we start with a peer learning exercise in October, starting by Belgium as the first volunteer country. And from now on, once a year, we have a platform of policymakers to exchange good example, and we go to one country to really have in-depth discussions also with stakeholders, NGOs, and everything. And then I don't know so much about funding in certain countries. That's why I don't really comment on the Ukraine. But what I wanted to comment on is agriculture. I have the feeling that all the time people say something about agriculture, my feeling is that for decades we were talking about transport. We have to reduce transport. Not that we were so successful in reducing transport. I mean, we go to e-mobility and this is all important. But still, many people have an own car and many the problems are the same than they were many years ago. And I think Luc said we want to establish contacts to farmers. And I think this is a good idea. I'm working in the Ministry for Agriculture and the Environment. We are one ministry for 16 years. But still, when we talk to kind of the other part of the ministry, you have the feeling that the agriculture people think we are a green NGO in their house. And then the other way around, this is not a lot better. So the agriculture people, when we come and talk to them, they always have the feeling we want to take away their money or everything, but they themselves have the feeling they contribute a lot to nature protection. They also do contribute to nature protection. So farmers do not only destroy nature, they also contribute to nature because our tourists are coming to the mountains because we have cows and we have farmers taking care of the meadows there. So. I think it is a very good idea for the NGOs, but also for the ministries to establish contacts to farmers. But I think we also have to be careful to not wanting everything from them, and so that the farmers are only afraid from the environment movement. Because I think in the long run we have to work together, as the NGOs and the ministries have to work together.
Indeed, thank you, Céline.
On the issue of regulation, just to confirm that, yes, I agree that there needs to be regulation. I think the key thing is to create a regulatory environment that can support positive innovation. So, but as I said, the minute you start talking about it, the other side thinks, oh, you're against regulation. No, so it's not for or against. It's just trying to find what sort of regulation will have the optimal results. And I remember talking with somebody from Unilever who keep, you know, complaining about regulation. I said, okay, let's get rid of all regulation. Do you think you would be able to compete? And he said, of course not. That's not what I want. So I think sometimes you also have to, you know, attack business when they make those sorts of knee-jerk comments because they're annoyed by the bureaucracy of it to get to the real discussion about what would constitute optimal regulation. The second thing on EU leadership abroad, I think there's a lot of things that the EU can do, and certainly in terms of funding, both in terms of its funding through the EIB or via all the development elements, there's more than the EU can do to be completely coherent in terms of making sure that its funding is not contributing to environmental degradation. And I agree that safeguards are not sufficient. The second thing, and it was mentioned by someone earlier, is transparency. I think in many countries, more transparency would really allow for a more rapid transition to a low-carbon economy. So supporting things like the open government partnership would be things that we need to continue doing, as well as the IRS Convention. Another one is the space for civil society. In many places in the world, environmental defenders are being killed. I mean, you know, every day. And I think the European Union is far too silent on those issues. So while on the platforms of the SDGs, it's all, you know, oh, civil society needs to be putting more pressure. Well, really, are we asking people to get killed? You know, under what conditions can actually civil society put pressure? There's also a big move to cut funding for civil society, because now much of the funding is meant to go to business as part of the so-called new innovative ideas on the development side. Well, if civil society can't speak anymore and doesn't have funding, how is it going to put pressure on governments to move?
Thank you, Céline. Nice that you ended on these kind of civil rights issues. So, yeah, thank you very much. And if you'd like to take your seats, we'll move to the final session. And in fact, it's not really a session, it's just closing remarks. And it is closing remarks. It's not I'm not going to give a summary at this point, because I'm the only thing, I think, standing between you and a very nice reception out there with some music. So the last thing I'm going to do is regurgitate in a much less articulate form the kinds of summaries that you've already heard just 1 hour ago from these three breakout sessions. I think it's been a fascinating, very, very interesting conference with discussions that have ranged from really quite high-level political themes to some very concrete proposals that came out of these three breakout sessions, concrete policies. And I think that's really something very rich for us to take away from here. One thing I will say about this conference is that for the EEB, it's really been an experiment to bring our annual conference outside of Brussels. We are always meeting in Brussels year after year. People are coming to Brussels, and we have interesting conferences, but we decided to take a risk and go outside Brussels, and we had an open process, and hey, here we are in Vienna, thanks to Umweltdachverband. And I'm not going to preempt, there'll probably be some kind of evaluation process to see was this good or not, but I'm already going to tell you, this has been a great conference. I'm really very, very pleased with this event, and I feel that a lot of you are as well from your reactions. I mean, we've heard today from many people the EU is not in good shape. This conference has taken place at a really critical time, not just for the environment, but for the whole EU project. And this is going back before the Brexit vote, but of course the Brexit vote has been the big event of the summer. Which has really brought a lot of issues up. Several people mentioned today that this is, it's a problem, but it's also an opportunity. It's raising questions, huge questions about the future direction of Europe. And we see many political leaders coming with what I think a lot of us in this room would see as the wrong answers. But we also see some kind of floundering moves towards some much better solutions. And we heard today, again, this call many times for a new narrative. We need a new and positive narrative. There is a very negative discourse out there, and I don't want to deny the truth in that. There are very disturbing currents. Xenophobia, nationalism have been mentioned today. But one thing that really stuck in my mind from this morning's presentation was to hear a climate campaigner being really, really optimistic, Ulrika, followed by our biodiversity speaker, Andreas, I don't know where he is, being similarly optimistic and reminding us that, he was reminding us that we are, every week, we are seeing some generous acts of people acting positively, for example, towards refugees, which are not, of course, making the headlines. So I know it's a glass half full, glass half empty, but I think that kind of, we need to focus on that positive energy and try to build on it. And in fact, the way forward is not so difficult to imagine, because a lot of this is already set out in the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. In terms of the big framework, it's there. It's been agreed by the governments. It's been agreed by the EU. And as with Paris, it just needs to be rolled out and implemented. And yes, it was disappointing that we don't see this in high-level speeches like the Juncker State of the Union address, as I said this morning. Although it's also noteworthy that the State of the Union address didn't go on with the old theme of better regulation, which I think was a positive thing that's worth mentioning. We are moving on several fronts inexorably outside the so-called safe operating space for humanity, but there is the possibility to pull back from the brink. And we see a lot of will, especially in this room, to do that, and we have concrete proposals about how that can be done. So I'm very happy that we've had this successful day, and I want to thank a few people. First of all, I want to thank our sponsors, and the Austrian government and the European Commission Life Programme in particular. I'd also like to thank Michi and his team from Umweltdachverband, especially Julika and Daniela, and the EEB team as well, and especially there Emma and Abraham. And here I'd like Sandra to help, because we would like to present those four people with some small token of appreciation. So. Yeah. So thank you very much to all of you. And in fact, of course, there is a bigger team behind both of these people, and they're in a way receiving them for others. But thank you very much. The logistics have gone very smoothly, apart from occasionally having a moderator who doesn't keep everybody to time. And that's me right now. So thank you very much. I invite you to move across the hallway to the place where we had lunch, and there you'll find a nice reception and some live music. The conference is closed. Thank you.